The following presentation is a gift from the team at Streamline Publishing, publishers of Fine Art Connoisseur, Plein Air Magazine, and weekly newsletters Fine Art Today, Realism Today, Plein Air Today, and American Watercolor, and events, the Plein Air Convention and the Figurative Art Convention. We offer over 400 different art instruction tutorials and ultra-high-quality video by the world's leading artists. If you like what you see, help us support our artists and our team with your purchase. Each video aired has a special discount code for today only in the comments section with a link to the video offered. And to see everything we do, or if you want to receive notice of new releases, new products, and new events for artists, simply click the other link, which says, "See everything we do." Thank you.
Hi, I'm Eric Rhodes, publisher and founder of Fine Art Connoisseur magazine. Thank you for joining us today. Each day at 3 p.m., we're offering you video samples of many of the 500 or so that we've produced. These are art instruction videos, and today is called The Color of White. It's fairly recent, and it's by the great Cheri Christensen. I hope you enjoy it.
Hi, I'm Cheri Christensen. I've been painting and teaching for over 25 years. My passion is for farm animals. I grew up in a small dairy and cattle ranching community, Enumclaw, Washington. And my grandfather was a cattle rancher, so that's really what influenced my painting of farm animals. Now today, we're gonna do a video called The Color of White. And the reason why I want students to concentrate on the color of white is because students see white and they just think white is light or just pure white, and white isn't. It reflects colors. White changes by the time of day you're out there, by the weather. If you took a duck and put it in a green field, it'd be different than if you had it on the dirt. So we're really going to concentrate on how you see the values in white, both the lights and what's happening in the shadows. And I'm doing ducks here, but this can be done on anything. So it could be their animals, it could be chickens, it could be a still life, it could be a woman in a white dress. So don't just think of it as, hey, we're painting ducks today. We're learning how to paint the color of white. Hi, and I'm here in beautiful Fredericksburg, Texas, and we are here today photographing the ducks. And the reason why we're doing this is because most students come and they have really not so good photos, and they want to make a great painting out of it. And so I'm here today to show you how to get a good photo. And part of the process is picking the time of day, the weather, what you want the painting to look like. And as you can see, it's a beautiful sunny day here. We've got late afternoon light. I get the backlighting I like, and that helps so I can use the reference photo and it will show the way I want the painting to come out. The importance of taking photos from life is the experience of being there. When you're out in real life, you can look at the shadows and you can see what color is in the shadow. And then the other part is, if you're just taking a photo offline or something like that, that's somebody else's composition. I want you to be the artist and find your own composition, and I want you to be part of the experience. Okay, when you're taking photos, have a good idea what you're looking for before you start. That way it's not like, oh, there's a duck, I'm just gonna photograph it. If you want something dramatically backlit, well, you need to go get on the shadow side of the duck. So you want to have an idea of what your composition is going to be before you even start. If you want something really moody, you might want, you know, either dark evening light, more shadow, just a little bit of light, or maybe even a foggy day. So have an idea before you start what it is you're looking for, and pick the right day and the right time to kind of convey that in your painting. So remember, when you're out taking photos, don't just take one or two photos and expect you're going to get the perfect photo with that. You need to take hundreds of photos. Try it different ways. You know, try getting down low. Decide your viewpoint. If it's a small animal, lay down on the ground if you need to. If you need to have a friend come help you with it, you lay on the ground, have them with the treats, bringing, you know, the animals up to you. But really take a lot of pictures. I've seen a lot of students, and they come and they have one or two, or we go out shooting animals and they go, oh, I've already got it. And I go, you've already got it? Well, yeah, I took a photo. That doesn't do it. Hundreds of pictures, because you might just find one or two in there, and then try it from different angles. You'd be surprised at what you can come up with if you're creative. So, you know, just get outside and go do it. That's it. All right, well, we've had a great time here. And what's next is going to be processing the photos. So we're going to get back to the studio and look at what we have and decide what's going to make a good painting. All right, well, we've had our duck shoot. And now we're back in the studio. I hope you've picked some of your favorite photos. I've picked mine. And I'm going to show you just a little bit of editing for it, how to make it a little more interesting, or at least I'm editing it the way I'd like it. You can make your own edits. I'm doing all of this on the iPad, so no special software, okay? So here we have three ducks. I don't want the one off to the right, so I'm just going to focus in on the other two. So I'm sure you know how you use your cropping tool. So just use your cropping tool, come in, select what you want, and that way you can see it close up. Once you've got the close-up shot, I look at this and go, okay, it's really interesting. I like the composition. But I want a little bit more. This was shot in RAW, so it didn't take quite the colors I was seeing there. So on the next shot, you're going to see I've dropped the exposure. That way I get a little more in the lights, because the whites get blown out when I do it kind of backlit or side lit. The shadows now have a little more color in it. I can tell what's light and shadow better, but I still want a little more pow. For that, I use vibrance, not saturation. Saturation gives just a little too acid of colors for me. So in the next one, we're coming in, and what I've done is just upped the vibrance level on this. As you can see, to me, it's much more exciting, much more interesting. And then I just tweaked it a little bit on the last one and just warmed up that vibrance just a little bit. So this is the one I'm using to paint from. You can see reflections in the shadows below. You can see the sky reflection above. Just much more interesting to me. All right, now that we've got our photo, I'm going to show you how to do a black and white value study. Value is the hardest part for students to get. So I think it's really important that at least at the start you try this. Even later on, if you painted more and more often, it's a good habit to do. Or if you have a problem with the painting, go back and do the value study. Okay, so this first screen you're going to see, and forgive my shadow at the top, that's just the easel there. I'm showing how you just lay in the drawing, just like we do in color, but now we're doing it with black and white. Okay, on the next screen, I've chosen my darkest area, the darkest dark, as the back behind the ducks there. The lower part, it gets a little lighter as it goes up. Then down by the duck's feet would be the next darkest value. And I know it's hard to tell on this one. I think on the next one, I've lightened it just a bit, so it's a little more obvious. Okay, yeah, here. So I've lightened that, so it's a little more obvious. And then the next dark value is the part above the ducks. Okay, so you've got the darkest, the second darkest, the third darkest. Now we're still in shadows, and this is going to appear light to some people. We have the darkest behind the ducks. We have the next darkest on the ground, the third up above the ducks, and now the fourth darkest is going to be on the ducks. Right now that looks like light, but that's because we don't have any of the light values. The duck to the left is slightly darker than the duck to the right. So the duck to the right is going to be your lightest shadow value. And that part of the breast of the duck there might be a little bit too light. As I go on with the other values, if it is, I'll knock it down. Okay, let's go to the next one. All right, so now we started with our light values. So my darkest light value is the light hitting on the water behind the ducks. So I just had to make it slightly lighter than the lightest shadow value. I know it's confusing, but just think, shadow always has to be darker than the light, but this is your darkest light value. Moving forward, we're on the grass of the ducks. So the grass down by their feet, that would be the second lightest light value. And then, this is the fun part, because once we get the light on the ducks, you can finally see that the ducks go in shadow. Okay, so I've done the duck on the right first, and then the duck on the left. Okay, so you can see you've got your darkest light value, your second one, and then light on the ducks as your highest value on the whole painting and the highest light value. And then just on the very last, I just showed some edges, losing some edges on it. Anyway, that's how you do your black and white value study. Paint on. Okay, now you know a little bit more about me. Let's go over some of the materials we'll be using together. First of all, in these cans, I have Gamisol. I like to keep one with clean Gamisol in it. The other one starts out clean, but I keep my brushes in this one. This is more for when you want to thin your paint, so you don't want to thin it with something that's already muddy with everything. My brush types, let me get this to wipe it off. Viva paper towels, of course. These are hog bristle brushes. I have an assortment of sizes. I have a lot of people saying to me they want to use more paint, be more painterly, have more thick paint. If you use a hog bristle brush, you get more paint on it, it leaves it on there, and you see the bristle marks on the painting. You do the synthetics, that's more for a smooth area. So that's why I use hog bristle. I want it to look like paint. So next, I'll show you the palette knife. There's tons of different palette knives out there. This is my favorite palette knife. My students know, stay away from my palette knife. I'll let them borrow it, but I've had this for probably 25 years. It's pretty much got my thumbprint on it. I just love it. The more you use a knife, the more it kind of wears to your hand. I just like, if you're looking at palette knives, trying them, go into a store where you can feel the flexibility. I use this for painting. I also use it for scraping my palette. Works great for both. So anyway, here it is. Okay, so now let's talk about paint. I use Gamblin brand. You can use whatever brand you want. But let me tell you a couple things. First, when you're dealing with something like a cadmium, the cheaper brands don't have as much cadmium in them. So some of the things I'm doing with my lights really need a lot of punch in the warmth of the paint. So I love, if you bought nothing else as an expensive one, buy this, because you can't do the same thing with the less expensive brands. Okay, let's get some paint out, and I'm going to show you how I organize my palette. This is a Gamblin Quick Dry White. I put a lot of paint out. If you want to paint with a lot of paint, you got to put a lot of paint out. That's the number one thing I find with my students. They have like little dabs like that. I can't paint with that. So I do on the white, because it gets dirty easy, I like to make it more like a snake. And then I'm kind of going around the color wheel. Every once in a while I'll change something, just because, like with my blues and greens, I can't always tell what's what. Okay, next I have cadmium light, yellow light. Cadmium Yellow Deep. I've got a bigger palette here than at home, so, which I love. Yellow Ochre, you can mix it, but I find it's nice to have it already made. I use a fairly limited palette, just because if you have a limited palette, Your painting's going to swim in the same range of colors. If you get too many and you're trying to match every color to what you think up there, everything isn't as cohesive. It's CAD red light. And alizarin permanent. They change their formula on alizarin permanent. So I'm gonna mix what I like because I like it a little darker than what I have here. So I mix just a little bit of phthalo green in with it to get it to be the value range that I want it to be. They are working on doing another, like a alizarin permanent deep. So I'm just gonna put a little dot here, even though it's out of order, but it helps me know how much I need to mix in with that. And I'm gonna mix it now so I don't forget for later. Okay, so I start with just a bit so I don't get it too dark. And if I do, I'll just add a little more alizarin because that's looking a little dark. Okay, so I'm going to add a little more of the alizarin. I don't mind if the color's a little bit broken either. It makes it more interesting. Okay, a little messy, but it'll work. And then I'll leave a little bit of that green there just in case. Okay, so I like my ivory black here. Then phthalo blue. Now here's where I change the color wheel a little bit. Phthalo blue and ultramarine are hard to tell which is which, so I put my phthalo green in the middle of it. I don't use as much of this, but I'll just put a little out. Okay, ultramarine blue. Again, I don't use as much as that, but we'll try it with that. All right, I'm just gonna go over my colors with you one more time. This is the quick dry white. This is the CAD yellow light. This is CAD yellow deep, yellow ochre, CAD red light, and my mixture of alizarin permanent slightly deepened with phthalo green. Then on this side, I'm gonna have ivory black. I have my phthalo blue, phthalo green, and ultramarine. All right, let's get started. Okay, now we get to the fun part. We're gonna do the lights. So what I'm gonna do first is clean my paint to make sure I'm not mixing in any of the darker colors, especially when my white's gonna need to be cleaned up. I'll probably have to clear off an area here too. But before I do, kind of take a good look at these are all shadow colors, but you know these are the ones that were in the darker values. You can see the ones on the duck are in lighter values. I don't want to say problem, but the trick is to make sure that I get my lights lighter than my darks. So that's my challenge. That's what I'm going to do. And I think I'm going to put out my two other blues just in case I need it for this. Okay, so I'm going to start working in here. I may have to bring in more of the dark in there too. But that is, out of my lights, this is probably the darkest light, then maybe that, or vice versa, just pick one. And then the grass would be the next. And then the light on the ducks is gonna be your pow punch. So you can pick, it's pretty close on both of them. You know, if you want this one to come forward more, pick that one. It just depends. You know, I'll play around with both and see how it goes. Let's see what that's like. Okay. It's gonna have to be lighter than that. And not quite as intense. But as I'm mixing here, I can see I'm getting really close to that. So, push it lighter. That's probably better with a tad more blue in it. That's closer. You know what I just realized I did? See, I make mistakes. I came all the way down to here and I missed the grass line, so I'm just gonna wipe that off. I realized when I went to look what color that was and realized it's grass. That's not gonna happen. I had this line where the grass was, but I have lost it. So I think it's in here. Here. And here. If it gets too confusing, I'll paint the grass first. But let's go forward. I'm gonna have to bring more of that dark in to make that read. And the dark. Okay.
Just certain spots that have that little glimmer hitting it. I don't want to do too much. I think I've got a little too much up there because I don't want it to detract from the ducks. It's kind of like, you know, in a movie, you got your star and you got your backup performers. This water is a backup performer. It's not the main thing. So you want it to help enhance what you've already got. Add a little more dark. I like the dark against the ducks better than the real light. So it's going to bring a little more of the dark shadow part in. I'll define this a little bit more when we get to modeling form. Right now, I just want to make sure I've got the big spots correct. I'm liking this side better over here. Just a slightly different blue. A little more ultramarine. Oops. Starting to paint the grass again. Just changing the color slightly over here to what I have on the other. Or similar. It has a little more green. Just trying to get a little more paint in there so it's not as mushy. So I'm seeing now that I've got lights on there that I have this too bright, so I'm going to knock that down. more. Because we can't have that jumping out to the light. Look like this got a little purple, probably picked up some alizarin here. This part in the middle has a lot more shadow in it than it does light. A little of this. Just a few more touches, then we'll go on to the grass. Okay, I'm gonna leave it right there right now. We'll get the grass in, the lights on the ducks. Then I'm gonna look at the hole. If it's too busy, then I'll kind of knock it down. Now this grass has the green, and it also has dirt. So I'll be adding, you'll see some colors. I'll have to put a little shadow in for the dirt, but then the other colors will be light. I try to just change my brush stroke. You don't want to do every little blade of grass because it will look funny. So again, it's just kind of keeping things big shapes, getting the value down, getting the color down. The little nuances, you can decide how much you want to do it of those at the end. Okay, so I'm just going to bring a little bit of the purpley stuff in there. I'm going to pull some green over that too, but just wanted to break it up. When you're doing something that's organic like this, good to look for ways to bring the eye around into the painting. So even though there's some shadow there, I'm going to make a kind of a little path of green that's coming across there. Just so it will lead you in. Then at the end, you decide which you want to keep and which you don't. I want to make it a little more green. It's coming forward. More blue into that. It's hard when you get down painting on the board like that. Probably towards the end, or if I was at home, I would take it, prop it up on the edge for a little bit, be risky, just so I can hit those little areas. Worst comes to worst, it's under the frame, but I like to be able to get my brush works, the strokes to go the way I want them to go. Lost his leg there. Just trying to do the negative shapes around that foot. So I'll keep its shape. Then calm that down a little bit. It's getting a little too much fun. And I think the angle does come up, but not quite that much. Also, not good to put your hands in paint. So if you want to do that, best use gloves. It's a bad habit. getting there. I want to bring a little more green back up into that. It's just a little darker shadow green in here. Should probably get a different brush. Something dark. And yes, I'm back into shadow, but I just need to make a few touches to it. It's just a little blue glinting off of some of the darker grass. And I'm afraid I'll forget it later. Okay, I'm just gonna take a step back, take a look at this. Then I'll have to clean off a little more room. We'll come to the real fun part, lights on the ducks. I guess I better put the lights on the beaks first, then the lights on the ducks, and we'll see if this all works where that looks like shadow. I have a few things to do before I can get to the real fun stuff, but I just wanna get the light, this is only leg and light, and get the light on the bills. And then we'll go to the fun part. All right, let's go. Really important to keep clean color. Okay. Got a little more yellow. Kind of going with the mid-tone here so I can save a little room for some highlight. Swim over a little bit far. And a little tall. There. Okay, we got this, guys. it turns more up here. Bill, I should say. And there's just a little light on this top part here. Okay, and wanted to bring the dark back over a little bit here. Okay, and then we have a foot. This one's in light. Might pull it over a little bit more. Got a little green in that orange there, so. Use this one as my blue one. This one is the lights. Okay. Ooh, brand new magic brush. I have it a little bit deeper in value there, but that's leave me some room to put some lighter ones on top of it. And I try to flick my brush somewhat to not leave like a, you know, a single line. It kind of breaks it up. Because ducks have feathers. But I'm also not trying to do individual feathers. It's really about painting what you see, not what you think. To bring this down a little bit more here. Now again, this is just the block, and I'll play around with edges and stuff more later. But you could see how our value here is lighter than that. A little cooler behind there. Sir Kate Bongard had a saying that you have to paint the dog before the fleas. So that's what all of this is. You're getting the big shapes before you do any details. People get so wrapped up in the details and they don't make a good foundation that it doesn't matter what you do with the details, you can't fake what's underneath. I don't do a lot of details, but that's how I like it. But you could, with this same start, go very detailed if you like. And anyway's fine. It's kind of, that's the art part. It's up to the artist. Okay, a couple more touches on this duck, and then he has his lights blocked in, or she. I really don't know. This part kind of comes in front, so I wanted to establish that first. And see, what we're showing here is it's, you know, warm, sunny day. We're showing the warmth come in from the sunlight on the lights. If it was a cloudy day, it would be a different color. Now that gets a little skinnier in there. And kind of blow this up a little bit so I can just see where that is. Okay. Got the curve, but the neck It's feeling a little skinny there. This comes up a little further. Might have curved it in there just a little more than I needed to. That's getting better. Okay, back to the lights. See the whole duck. Okay, that's it for today. Light and shadow, that's what it's all about. Color. Tomorrow we'll come in, work on modeling the form, do light and dark accents, and check on the edges. See you tomorrow. Hi, I'm Cheri Christensen, and welcome to my video, The Color of White. In this video, I hope to enhance your painting skills while painting the color of white. By studying the color of white, you'll be learning values, and they will help you in whatever kind of painting you are trying to do. It's not about copying a photo. It's about deciding which is warmest, which is coolest, which is lightest, which is darkest, which is grayest, which is more intense in color, which is the sharpest edge and which is the loosest edge. Everything is relative. So your painting's your little world there, and everything's relative on it. And that's what we're gonna work on, is you comparing those. So in this video, what I think is unique is you get answers, you get simplified answers, tried and true way of painting, of comparing values, comparing color, comparing intensity, so you can solve the problems yourself. You can answer your own questions. In my paintings, I like light to play the funnest role. That's why I like, you know, late afternoon, early evening settings. I just love when light just dances across a blade of grass, just touching the tops of things. So I really use it as a pathway to bring someone into the viewer into the painting, little surprises here and there, maybe subject matter they aren't used to, but the light brings them in. So I have a blast with light. The world inspires me. Just going out, if you really start to learn how to see, you will be so in awe. Just get yourself out. Once you start doing that, I mean, when I first learned how to see, I almost got in a wreck because you're just looking at color and light everywhere. Go out and be in the early morning light, late afternoon light, whichever, you know, end you want to be on. But, you know, sometimes you might be late for dinner. So what? You know, you'll still eat anyway. But don't miss that magical hour, because once you do that, it's as much fun as painting. And I can be out there with the animals. One, I get to be grounded. And two, I can see the painting. When I get that photo, I'm like, that's it. I know what I want to paint. Once you get those kind of photos and you teach yourself how to do that, you don't need inspiration, because all you want to do is get back in the studio and paint it.
Well, that is a piece of The Color of White. The whole idea about painting whites is really important in painting. That's Cheri Christensen, and you can learn more about that whole video at lilyartvideo.com. Remember, there's a special discount code in the comments section to be used today only. Now, let's have some fun and get right to our interview with Cheri Christensen. Hi, welcome to Interviews with the Artist. I'm Eric Rhodes, publisher of Fine Art Connoisseur and Plein Air magazines. Today, our guest, Cheri Christensen.
Hi, I'm Cheri.
Hi, Cheri. So welcome.
Thank you.
Well, we're really excited about having you here with us today and to learn so much more about painting and about your career. You have been painting for how many years now?
At least 25.
25 years.
Yeah.
So what was that journey like? How did you begin this journey?
I like to say, or I used to say, I had an early midlife crisis, but that was when I was 30, so I can't really call it midlife then. But you know, when you're 30, you think you're old. I was in retail. I was a clothing buyer. I went into real estate. I did a lot of different things. Actually, it was good to have a business background before I went into this. And then my cousin was a painter, or just as a hobbyist, and I asked her to show me how to paint, and we did that. But she kind of just copied things. And I really wanted to know how to really paint. And so I asked some people, and they said, go to art fairs, find, you know, artists that whose work you like, because you don't want to just take from anyone. And so I went around, and I found this woman's work I really liked, and I asked her who she studied with. And she said Ron Lucas. Uh-huh. And he was in downtown Seattle. So at this time, I was in a small country town, Enumclaw, Washington. And I'm like, wow, that's an hour and a half away. I went and checked it out. Classes are from 7 at night to 10. And be like, I'll be getting home at midnight. But I wanted to do it so bad, I did it. And would drive in there once a week and study with him. I felt like my drawing skills, I mean, here we're doing portraiture, and I had gotten A's in college in art, and I'd never drawn a head on a person. I don't know how.
Right.
You know, you think someone would go, you're leaving the heads off. And they just thought I was being creative. And somehow I got A's, and you know, I had told Ron Lucas that I wasn't comfortable with my drawing skills. And he said, well, don't stop painting. Just come one more night a week. We'll stick you right up front, just on the sawhorse there, and you can draw. I was scared to death, especially with all the artists behind me. But I learned you have to just do things even if you're scared to death to
Absolutely.
Do them. So that got me started. And I knew Ron wasn't going to continue to teach for much longer. He wanted to go back to California. So I studied with him as much as I could. I followed him like a groupie. I went down to the Businessmen's Art League in California and painted with guys from Disney. Whatever I had to do, I did. And just soaked up as much knowledge as possible. Then went out there and feeling very scared and vulnerable. I either knew I had to go back to my old life in retail, which meant I wouldn't have time to paint, or I had to find a way to make a living. And the only thing my teacher didn't show me was a roadmap of how to make a living, because he was just working in his own studio and living in the same place at that time.
Well, I want to talk about that, and we're going to get to that in a second, but I think that something you've described is a very important thing for people to really understand, and that is that learning something, anything, but especially art, has to be driven by a passion.
Yes.
Right? So describe the passion that you think people need to be able to kind of drive their art. What do they need to be doing?
You have to be driven. I mean, there has to be something in you. And people talk about talent, and I've met lots of talented artists. But the ones that go somewhere are the ones with passion. Sometimes the people with talent, it comes too easy. They don't try as hard, so they don't grow as much. If I get a student that has passion and they will actually listen and do what I say, they can go anywhere. I mean, I have students that are showing now. But it's the ones that have the passion, the ones that don't make excuses.
Well, that's a great debate, too, because there are a lot of people who, I'll be outdoors painting, and they'll walk up and they'll say, I wish I could do that, but they always say the same two things. I can't draw a stick figure,
yeah.
And I don't have any talent. And I always say to them, you don't have to have talent, that painting can be like a learned skill. Yes, there are people who have natural talent, but most of that natural talent came from their passion. Most of the people I find that had natural talent, you talk to them, and when they were little kids, they were so passionate about it, they just drew all the time.
And encouraged.
Right. So it's really, talent isn't really required. Do you ever get to a point where it enters in and you have to have talent?
I think if you're passionate about it, you have to want to do it so bad that you will learn, you will study. You might have to work more hours than someone that's more talented, or maybe where it comes more natural, but it can be taught. It can be taught.
So what are the lessons, if you were gonna sit down with somebody and coach them, and let's say that I'm a new person and I said, Cheri, I wanna learn how to paint from start to finish. Mm-hmm. What are you gonna tell me that I should do, and in what order?
What I would tell you is we're gonna start from square one. I would start you out with still life with a controlled lighting source. I would start you out doing value studies. Value is the hardest thing for students to get. I see painters showing out there that don't have values done correctly. So yes, I would go start with basics, start with the still life, simple objects, do black and whites until you get the value part done. Once you have the value part down, then we start working on color. It's a step-by-step approach, but it works. And some people, yes, click quicker than others, but everyone can go at their own pace. But what I tell people is, don't just paint when I'm there, when you're with me at a workshop. Go home. It really is acres and acres of canvas. You have to keep working at it. But it helps if you're working with a teacher. I hear so many people saying, I'm self-taught. And I'm thinking, would you go to a self-taught surgeon? You know, it's...
I did, and I lost an arm over there.
Yeah, it wouldn't be good. So you want to have a teacher, one, whose work you like and admire, and two, you need to do the homework. And that's myself and my littermate, I call her my littermate, Pam Ingalls, because we were both studying at the same time. What helped is I had her there, and we would go, we'd go in, we'd paint at this art league during the morning, we'd break for lunch, we'd paint again in the afternoon, set up our own, we'd do models in the morning, still life in the afternoon, then we'd go to Ron's class, and we would bring in everything we did, our homework. No one else did this but us, and he would critique it. And I tell you, there were times where I wanted to cringe and crawl out the floor, you know, just under the door, because it's really hard, especially when you're a sensitive person, to put yourself out like that. But it's the only way I could go forward.
So that's another important lesson, and that is that, you know, put yourself out there, be willing to accept critique. So that's the hardest thing still for me.
Yes, it is.
Even though I've gotten to the point where I can paint fairly well, not great, but fairly well, mm-hmm. it's still like cringe time when somebody's like giving you that critique. But if you can just shed that, and that's what I had to do, is I just had to learn to shed it and say, you know, I got to have this, because they can see what you can't see.
Right. And the thing is, in your brain, you know, your critic is beating up on you much more than the teacher is going to do it. And that's what I try to tell my students. Just stop that critic, you know, because it gets in the way. I will help you through it. And I can do it in a way that's much nicer than that critic in your head. So to me, I don't come up and see, oh my God, that's a monster, it's a mess, I can't fix it. I can just see what needs to be tweaked. I don't like to say it's wrong, it's a process. So what we're doing is putting paint up, and then we're looking at the relationships and we're making adjustments. We're so worried in this country of doing things wrong that sometimes people just, they're frozen. And I think you have to get over that in painting.
You know, one of the things that I also find is that people need to have constant encouragement. And if they don't have anybody around encouraging them, they've just got to never give up.
Right.
Because I had some friends that enrolled in an art class, same guy, same time I did, and they stopped. And they actually, I thought they had some natural talent, but they got frustrated too fast and they left it. And now I look back, you know, 25, 30 years later, and they've missed out on all of this, and they're always talking about, oh, we love your work and we love what you're doing. And I just cringe when I see people give up. So just never give up.
Never give up. That is it. And it is, it kills me if I see a student that, you know, they say they want to do this so bad and then they're not doing it. And, you know, I'll only ask them so many times, hey, how's it going? What have you been working on? And when they're turning away or embarrassed to run into me, I'm like, okay, I'm going to quit asking you, because it's obviously not as important to you, and that's fine. If someone decides they don't want to do it, then decide you don't want to do it. But don't keep saying, well, I can't, because you can. It's just a choice.
How important is it, let's say I want to learn how to do landscape painting, you would still start me out with still life?
I would.
Okay, explain why that is.
Simpler forms. People get out with landscape, and then they become overwhelmed. They see little tiny tree limbs and stuff like that, and it's really about big shapes. So if you learn, you know, how to paint an apple, a pear, things like that, you get out in the landscape and you can kind of learn how to do that tree as the big shape, the form first, the light and the shadow on it. Then you can add how much little detail. The beginners, their problem is they get in and they see all the leaves. And Sergei Bungard had a saying, you got to paint the dog before the fleas. Okay, so on a tree, you've got to paint the shape, the form, before you get in doing all the little leaves. So save the detail for the end, just like a house, foundation, structure first. Then you get to put it on, the little lights and ornaments that you want.
Now, you're in the lineage of Sergei Bungard, who was a great Russian artist who came to America. I think he was in Idaho and California.
Yes, yeah.
And then you studied under one of his students.
Yes, Ron Lucas.
So that's a huge thing. And Sergei had, if I remember correctly, even if you wanted to be a landscape painter, he made you paint still lifes and portraits.
Yeah.
So explain why portraits are also important to learn the overall part of painting.
Well, one, you have a person sitting still, so it's not changing, it's not moving like a landscape is. You also have a controlled lighting source. So it's, the still life, it's a step up from still life because you have a person, but also a person is moving and not going to be a still object. But if you do those, and that's the same thing Ron taught, you do those first to get everything down. Then you can move out into an ever-changing landscape and changing light, leaves moving, but mainly the light source changing.
Yeah, well, when you think about it, a landscape is a giant still life with about 1,000 objects in it.
Mm-hmm.
It's just like, cylinders are trees, big ones, little ones, limbs are cylinders, treetops or balls, et cetera. So you really want to get trained in that. And I assume that that's really true for any, like plein air painting too, is you really want to learn it indoors before you take it outdoors, just so that you don't have all this extra stuff to think about.
Right. Because once you get outdoors, I look at the artist's job is to simplify this chaos for the viewer to bring them where you want to bring them. So even like, my animals are photographed outdoors. I have done sketches outdoors, but they do move a lot, so it's kind of hard to do. But if I had never done paintings still life inside, you need to learn how to paint before photos. You need to paint from reality. You need to do the portraits. You need to do the still life where you can look and learn how to see colors. Photos take, usually make things a little darker and a little lighter, pull it apart more. You can't see as many of the colors. We're getting better because with editing, we can bring up some shadows, bring down some light, so it helps. But I wouldn't be able to do this if I hadn't studied, the basics first. So I would say you want to learn still life first and then portraiture and then bring yourself outside and then learn from photos.
Yeah, so being outside is an important part of the discipline.
Oh yeah, yeah.
And that's something that a lot of studio painters, I've met hundreds, who have never gone outside to paint, mm-hmm. never even looked out the window to paint.
Right.
And how does it change things?
Well, I think, because even though I do most of my painting inside now, I do go out and take all my own photographs. And I used to do it with a video camera so I could even make notes when I was starting. Okay, this is what the lighting is. I'm not going to be able to see all this. This is what's happening, the feel of the mm-hmm. day. Now I don't have to do that anymore, and cameras are a lot better, so you get a lot more color in it. But it's still, that's why I wanted to show the photo shoot in our video, because I couldn't make my connection to the ducks the same if I hadn't been out there with the ducks and how it felt to be out there with them and to be able to see the light and color, what moved me, what made me passionate about why I wanted to do the painting and what gave me the energy to do the painting. If I didn't bring that to it, if I just pulled this photo off online or something, you're missing the essential part that the artist brings to the painting.
Right.
It's the experience.
So how would you describe yourself as an artist?
How would I describe myself as an artist?
Well, for instance, if you were on the telephone with somebody and you had to tell them what it is you do, what you paint and why you paint it.
Okay. Well, first I would say, if you want a general term, I paint in the style of the Russian Impressionists. I'm not Russian, so I'm not going to say I'm Russian Impressionist, but I paint in the tradition of that.
Which is a very rich and important tradition.
Oh, it is. And I'm so glad, you know, I'm seeing more and more of it. But for a while, you couldn't find anything on it. So I'm really happy that it's out there more. But then I would go on to say that my passion, I grew up in a small farming community. My grandfather was a cattle rancher, cattleman of the year. And I was around, that. And a part of it, and it feels like it's a part of me and my life and my heritage. So when I was studying and I was doing still life and portraiture, and I was like, what am I going to paint, you know? I mean, what's going to be me? And I looked around, and at that time I had a small house in Enumclaw and a couple acres. I had Angora goats. I had a bunch of sheep. I had a bunch of chickens, dogs, cats. And then it clicked. This is who I am. But I was kind of stuck because I was taught to paint from life. And I thought, can I paint from a photo? And is that, you know, I thought, oh no, that's wrong. You're not supposed to do that. But mainly when I say that, it's you don't want to start out that way as a student because you won't learn. You need to learn from life. But then it's fine to use it as a reference later. And when I did some of my first animal paintings, I didn't show them to my instructor. And my husband at the time had a surprise birthday party for me and invited him. And I had paintings all over my little house. And I wanted to go up. Some of them weren't done, you know. And I wanted to just kind of pick and choose and pull things off the wall. But you can't do that in the middle of a party. And he saw my animal paintings and he loved them. So my feeling of, oh gosh, I did it from a photo, it's fine. It's who I am. The animals are a part of me. So often I hear students, they don't know what to paint. They don't know who they are yet. I knew who I was and just didn't realize I could make that part of my painting. Once I did, I knew who I was.
Well, and it comes across too. You can tell when an artist is passionate about their subject because they do it so well. And you're passionate about your subject. And if somebody's painting something just because somebody said, hey, do me a painting of of this or that, you can just tell their heart's not in it. But you can really tell when somebody's heart is in it, and your work really reflects that. I think your heart really shows your love and passion.
Well, thank you.
So talk to me about painting whites.
Okay.
Because for artists, this is one of the most misunderstood pieces of art.
Right. So painting the color of white, what's so important about that is most people just think white, you know, straight to, they think they've got the answer. Oh, this one's easy. I've got white. There's white on my palette. I'll just put white down. But they don't realize white is, it has to be a part of the whole situation. Whatever your painting is, whether you're outside, inside, using photos, white reflects colors. So your shadows are going to be reflected colors. Your lights are going to be dependent on the light source. The hardest thing for students is to think of white as being in shadow. Just like on the ducks, part of it's in shadow. So that shadow area, they just think is just a little slightly darker version of white, you know, maybe slightly gray, but it's not dark enough to fall into their whole shadow range, and they aren't seeing the color that's reflected in the shadow. So the most important thing with whites is to make sure your shadow value, it might be your lightest shadow value, but it still stays in your shadow values.
Well, there's a famous painting that Whistler did of a woman in a white dress.
Yes,
and
beautiful.
If you really study that painting, I don't think there's any pure white in it.
Right.
But it glows as if it's white because of what's surrounding it and because of the supporting cast, if you will, the supporting colors.
Yeah.
And that's essentially what you have, I think, mm-hmm. is one of your superpowers. So tell me about your other superpower.
My other superpower that not everyone thinks is a superpower, but I do, is that I'm sensitive. And when I was young, I was very sensitive, and people would tease me and, you know, say, oh, you're just too sensitive. And then I was in a drawing class, and Henry looked at me, and he goes, you need to be more sensitive. And I was just like, jaw drop. No one in my life has ever told me I needed to be more sensitive. And I thought about it and thought about it and went, I'm in the right place. So I knew I'd found my tribe. Being sensitive to not only, you know, color and light and relative colors, but also to who you're working with, and the animals, if you're shooting animals, whatever, if your models, all of that is part of the experience. And those of us, I thought everyone could feel the same things, but now that I'm older, I understand it is a superpower that not everybody else is as sensitive to what is happening around them. And that sensitivity has helped me in my painting.
Well, you know, I discovered I had an aha moment the other day. It's only taken me 300 years to get to that aha moment. But that moment really had to do with the fact that I oftentimes used to think that, you know, you look at artists, most people consider artists to be really creative people and somewhat sensitive people. I think actually for most of us, not yourself necessarily, mm-hmm. most of us, it's the act of art that makes us more intuitive and more sensitive. Mm-hmm. It because you cannot stay focused on painting without developing the sensitivity for color and for light and for shade and for form and all of these little things. And as a result, we live life differently as artists.
Yeah.
You know, you're driving down the road. It probably happened, you know, when you're driving home tonight, you're gonna see a sunset and you're gonna be thinking differently about that sunset than somebody who would be riding in your car.
It's the coolest thing. Once I learned how to see, the world was like all a big aha. I mean, you're so excited. And when this happens to students, I get so excited because it opens up a whole different world. You look at things you never looked at before. You could look at a mud puddle and find it beautiful. Just the colors reflecting in it. It's such a cool thing.
And it changes your life.
Yeah.
It really does. And for the people who might be viewing this who are not artists or haven't really tried it yet, what would be your pitch to them for giving it a try?
It'll change your life. I mean, really it will. It'll help you, one, be more sensitive, two, be more grounded. I mean, it is really kind of a spiritual thing. It's almost like a meditation. Once you get to a point where you're not beating yourself up while you're doing it, you know, there's learning periods and anything. But your world will change, just not your art world, but your whole view of the world will change.
Well, this has been absolutely wonderful, but I have one more question to ask you before we go, and that is about the business of art. You said earlier in the interview that you had learned some things in business when you were younger and before you became an artist. This is one of my big goals, is to help artists understand the business aspects, the understanding that to be able to make a living as an artist, you have to have and embrace some of those things. Can you talk to some of the things that you've learned that might be helpful?
Sure. One of the things, if you're working with galleries, the galleries appreciate the most, and they do love me for it. They tell me that. I get them things on time. You know, artists complain, why wasn't it in this magazine or that? I make deadlines. And artists, you know, like to think, well, because I'm an artist, I'm self-employed, I can just la-di-da along. Well, you can, but if you want to make money as an artist, you do have to be disciplined on the business side. And so I think it really helps that I do, along with the artist side, have a business background. So I know how to make deadlines. I know how to use a computer. If I don't, I'll Google it. I'll figure out, you know, if something I need to do. I'm trying to go out and hit new areas, you know, my Facebook business page, pushing that, Instagram. New things to find new collectors or new students. And I think it's important to keep growing the whole time. I mean, I'm still learning.
You know, when you're in business, you have to be constantly, you can't be a one-track mind, you have to be a 50-track mind. You know, you have to, you know, some people will base their entire business on one thing, and then that one thing comes crashing down, and then they have nothing.
Right.
And so that might be you know, one gallery or one collector base mm-hmm. or one medium or something, so you have to do more. I had a gallery tell me that they fired an artist because the artist missed the deadlines for their show. They had the catalog waiting to be printed, mm-hmm. the materials didn't right. come in, they were ready to do the show, and it really messed up their calendar because they had to push it back. And so they ended up doing the show, but everything was late, and then after that show, they fired the artist. They said, right. we cannot tolerate this kind of behavior.
And it's not fair to the galleries. I mean, I work with galleries, and I know some artists complain about it, but to me, I ran my own gallery for a while. I didn't get as much work done. Once I quit doing my own gallery, although it was a good learning experience, it was a gallery slash studio slash teaching workshop at night. And it was a good learning experience, but I learned how much work a gallery puts into it and how much of my effort went into doing that rather than painting. And so I have decided I'm going to do what I'm best at, which is the painting. And yes, they get a good cut, but they're doing what they're best at. And for me, that makes my life simpler. Now, I still have to be a photographer, one, for shooting the animals. Two, I shoot all my own paintings because I cannot afford. I used to pay someone to do it, but that really adds up. And to be honest, some of it didn't come out any better than what I've learned to do. I hired a photographer to show me how to set up the lights, told me what I needed to get, and did all of that. So I shoot my own work. I'm also my advertising person. Let's see, what else? I mean, there's a lot of different hats that you have to put on.
How much of your time do you spend on the career part of your business that's not painting?
Oh, it's quite a bit, actually. I would say in a day, I'm probably 70% painting and 30% career mm-hmm. stuff. I'd rather be painting. So some days it might be like I'm doing the whole part career stuff because, well, the other day I was just painting and it was going great and I'm not going to stop when things are working well. But then I have to get this done, you know. So I make notes on my computer's alarms to go off because I'll forget. I've got a whiteboard, what has to be to what gallery, when. And we have to pack, ship our work, frame our work, make sure you have, you know, boards or canvas in stock, have frames ready to go, because all of this stuff has to be timed to get it out to the gallery on time.
I think, you know, the average person who sees a piece of art hanging on a wall in a gallery has no idea what an artist has to go
yeah.
through.
Right.
And the organizational skills that are necessary. Well, this has been really wonderful having you here. We're honored to have you in the studio today, and thank you for your time.
Thank you. Honored to be here.
Well, this has been Interviews with the Artist and Cheri Christensen. Cheri, thank you.
Thank you. Paint on.
Well, that's Cheri Christensen, and the video is called The Color of White. And you can learn more about the entire video at lilyartvideo.com. Remember, there's a special discount code in the comments section that is to be used today only. Take advantage of it. Well, thank you for being here today. We've got a video for you, a free one. It's worth over $107. It's called 97 Amazing Painting Secrets from the World's Best Artists. And you can find it for free at 97tips.com. Thanks for watching. I'm Eric Rhodes.
Hi, I'm Cheri Christensen, and welcome to my video, The Color of White. In this video, I hope to enhance your painting skills while painting the color of white. By studying the color of white, you'll be learning values, and they will help you in whatever kind of painting you are trying to do. It's not about copying a photo, it's about deciding which is warmest, which is coolest, which is lightest, which is darkest, which is grayest, which is more intense in color, which is the sharpest edge and which is the loosest edge. Everything is relative, so your painting's your little world there, and everything's relative on it, and that's what we're gonna work on, is you comparing those. So in this video, what I think is unique is you get answers, you get simplified answers, tried and true way of painting, of comparing values, comparing color, comparing intensity, so you can solve the problems yourself. You can answer your own questions. In my paintings, I like light to play the funnest role. That's why I like, you know, late afternoon, early evening settings. I just love when light just dances across a blade of grass, just touching the tops of things. So I really use it as a pathway to bring someone into the viewer into the painting, a little surprises here and there, maybe subject matter they aren't used to, but the light brings them in. So I have a blast with light. The world inspires me. Just going out, if you really start to learn how to see, you will be so in awe. Just get yourself out. Once you start doing that, I mean, when I first learned how to see, I almost got in a wreck because you're just looking at color and light everywhere. Go out and be in the early morning light, late afternoon light, whichever, you know, end you want to be on. But, you know, sometimes you might be late for dinner. So what? You know, you'll still eat anyway. But don't miss that magical hour, because once you do that, it's as much fun as painting. And I can be out there with the animals. One, I get to be grounded. And two, I can see the painting. When I get that photo, I'm like, that's it. I know what I want to paint. Once you get those kind of photos and you teach yourself how to do that, you don't need inspiration, because all you want to do is get back in the studio and paint it.